Welcome to Vigorous Performance Enhancing Drugs, everybody's favorite topic. I'm Coach Steve. Let's discuss how to design your own cycle, because I get messages on a daily basis with the most complicated cycles ever. And they're more complicated than an IKEA instruction manual. It would probably be easier to build your own closet or your own kitchen cabinet. So let's start all the way at the beginning. Testosterone, which is the foundation, the base, the bioidentical hormone that every cycle should be based on. Unless you experience hair loss, and then you might want to consider nandrolone, but we're not going to go over that. That's been discussed a million times previously. The base hormone that you want to start with for your cycle is testosterone. Now, what are the dosages? The dosages could range from 100 milligrams testosterone enanthate per week to 2,000, 4,000, 6,000, depends on your rate of development. I've heard 5,000 milligrams testosterone enanthate per week. It seems like a little bit much to me, even though I've personally taken 2,000 milligrams of testosterone enanthate at the end of a cutting phase, just to keep the anabolism in place. Yeah, it was a very low calorie diet, so increasing the dosages of your testosterone as the calories come down to get the same amount of anabolism, because you need anabolism from food and from performance enhancing drugs. And when one goes up, the other one goes down. So when the food goes up, the steroids can go down as well. Yeah? Keep that in mind. It's very essential that you understand this, because a lot of guys in the off season, they just blast their socks off, when in reality, most of the anabolism is going to come from food, and you really don't need that much anabolic steroids, growth hormone, insulin, or whatever you're taking to facilitate recovery, anabolism, hyperplasia, etc. Yeah? Start at the beginning. You go on steroids, start with testosterone first. It's bioidentical. It's what your body was producing, unless you were not producing sufficient amount of testosterone and then you have a medical reason to replace that with exogenous use. 100 milligrams, 125 milligrams, 150, maybe 200 milligrams, 250, 300. Yeah, it highly depends on what you like to start with. Personally, I like a little bit more testosterone, what's traditionally prescribed in a testosterone replacement therapy or a hormone replacement therapy protocol. I like to start with 1 milligram testosterone enanthate for each pound of body weight that I have, or 2 kilos of body weight. So in my case, I'm about 105 kilos or 225 pounds, which is 225 milligrams of testosterone enanthate per week. Now, to be fair, one ampule of testosterone comes in 250 milligrams. So I take one ampule, 250 milligrams of testosterone per week. That's my starting dose. And you can consider that a generous hormone replacement, a cruise, or a bridge in between steroid cycles. And that appears to be, which is the case for myself and all of my clients, to be the lowest effective dose of testosterone per week, which you require to maintain all the size you've built during the off season. When you were doing a real steroid cycle, you go down to 1 milligram testosterone per 1 pound of body weight, and you should be able to maintain all your size of strength as long as you're in a decent calorie surplus. So where do we go from here? You found out your lowest effective dose of testosterone, and then you try to find the highest dose of testosterone, which you can tolerate without side effects. Now, for some people, that's only 250 milligrams of testosterone per week. Some that's 500, some that's 1,000, some that's 1,500, 2,000. I've heard guys tolerate up to 3,000 milligrams of testosterone per week without any real side effects. So their lipids are still in range, their blood pressure is manageable, there's no hair loss, or they don't care about hair loss. There's no acne, they can control their estrogen levels, there's not too much water retention, yeah, but it's going to be different for everybody. And the only real way to figure that out is by taking a step-by-step process. You do it slow over time. You don't go from 250 test to 3,000 and then you taper off until the side effects go away. It's not the correct approach. Take it step-by-step. 250 milligrams of testosterone per week, you give yourself adequate time on that dose to make as much progress as you can before increasing the dose with an increment of 250 milligrams further. So you go from 250 to 500, 750 to 1,000. Now, the estrogenic side effects, you can easily mitigate by using an aromatized inhibitor, preferably aromacin, because it doesn't impact your lipids as much as letrozole or Arimidex does. Or you use an estrogen metabolizing supplement like dienylmethane and calcium deglucurate. Now, I've got a whole ebook dedicated to prolactin, progesterone, and estrogen. You can find it on my website, vigorsteve.com/shop, where all the details are already mentioned in Well, more than you'll find anywhere else, that's for sure. So the estrogenic side effects, as long as you control that, should also help with the water retention and the potential for blood pressure increases, because estrogen water retention contributes to blood pressure. And you can manage your blood pressure with several different methods. You can use medication, for example, an ACE inhibitor or an ARB blocker or Cialis, which is a little bit off-label use, but it does keep your blood pressure in a healthy range. Make sure your electrolyte intake is stable and consistent on a day-to-day basis. I already did a video about that yesterday. I would highly advise you to watch that, because consistent electrolyte intake keeps your blood pressure stable as well. So the blood pressure and the estrogen, you can probably easily mitigate depending on the dose of testosterone. But at one point, you reach a dose of testosterone where other side effects start to occur. For example, hair loss, and even though you're using a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor or a special shampoo or a research chemical to prevent the progression of androgenetic alopecia, they're not potent enough because your dose of testosterone is too high. Or you get water retention from the dose of testosterone itself, even though you're already keeping your estrogen in range and you're managing your electrolyte intake. Or digestive issues like acid reflux, for example, or you get severe night sweats because your metabolic rate is increasing from the dose of testosterone that you're taking, or severe anger management issues, which happens for some people as well, then at one point you'll reach your personal maximum tolerable dose of testosterone you can take per week without causing too much side effects, or at least side effects that are manageable and, well, tolerable. If you want more anabolism on top, you'll have to look at another compound, and whatever goal you have and which side effects you got with testosterone kind of depends on which compounds you can add on top of your maximum dose of testosterone, right? So there's several different ways to determine that. So let's look at your red blood cell count and your hematocrit level on testosterone only. So let's say you were taking 750 milligrams of testosterone per week. Your hematocrit went sky high. Yeah, you get a lot of erythropoic action in your body, and you get a lot of red blood cell count and a very high hematocrit. Boldenone, primobolan, and trenbolone are off the table. Anadrol as well, yeah, that's the oral. Primobolan, boldenone, trenbolone, and anadrol, because they're way more erythropoic than testosterone is. So even though you want to increase anabolism, your hematocrit is already high on testosterone, and these compounds are going to increase your hematocrit a lot faster and further than testosterone was doing, especially if you're focusing on your nutrition and you get sufficient amounts of iron and vitamin B12 in your diet. So please keep in mind that whatever side effects you experienced on your maximum tolerable dose of testosterone are going to get exacerbated depending on which compounds you choose. So for example, you experienced hair loss or acne or both. All the DHT-based compounds are off the menu. You can't take that because they're going to exacerbate the acne or the hair loss. That's no Primo, no Masterone, no Winstrol, no Anavar, no Proviron, no Superdrol, no Anadrol. Am I missing one? I'm sure I'm missing a few. But any of the DHT-B compounds are now off the table. You can't take those because they're going to exacerbate the hair loss. You have your maximum dose of testosterone that you can take. Maybe it's only 300 milligrams. You're controlling that with finasteride. And now a suitable alternative anabolic on top of your testosterone is going to be nandrolone or boldenone. Only those two are known not to progress androgenetic alopecia. So again, it really depends on how you respond to testosterone, which other compounds you can take. Now, if you didn't get these side effects, but your lipids are really skewed on testosterone only at your maximum tolerable dose, it's going to be a little bit difficult on which compounds to choose, because most anabolic steroids and some of the SARMs are going to skew your lipids further. So you'll have to put some sort of lipid management in place, which is in the form of a citrus bergamot supplementation or red yeast rice or fish oil, or reducing your dietary cholesterol intake, or increasing your fiber intake. There's many different methods. Get that under control first before you look into some of the other compounds, because they're going to skew your lipid levels probably more than testosterone already did. And if it's not the case, your lipids are acceptable. A Winstrol, for example, a Trenbolone, a Masterone, I think even Anavar, and most of the orals for that sense, they're going to skew your lipids, and you really have to keep track of that to make sure you don't skew them too much and get this weird reading like a 20 HDL and a 200 LDL, and then super high triglycerides. Again, it all contributes. Keep that in mind, please. Now, the last thing you have to look at is your kidney function and your liver function. And there's several different things that play into that. For example, high blood pressure will change your kidney function by itself already, regardless of what compound you use, or maybe you already had high pre-existing blood pressure before you started taking steroids. Again, all those things you need to mitigate. Now look at blood pressure management. Now, some of the steroids were actually examined for their kidney toxicity. So if you have impaired kidney function or it's not as high as you'd like it to be, trenbolone and boldenone are off the table because both were shown to be kidney toxic directly besides the blood pressure increases that these compounds might induce. Now, when you look at the liver, I'm sure everybody knows this, all of the orals are going to tax your liver to a certain extent. So if your liver enzymes are already off and you see some of the other markers skewed on testosterone only, forget about the orals, leave them off the table until you get your liver health checked and everything is back into range. Now, when it is in range and you want to add an oral, some of the orals are going to skew your lipids a little bit more than others, and some of them are going to tax your liver more than others. Now, the dose and the duration also plays a factor in how much liver stress you'll get from an oral steroid. So what I feel is reasonably safe from a liver perspective, Anavar, Proviron, DHEA, pregnenolone, and most of the other compounds, especially Anadrol, Superdrol, and Halotestin, put a lot of stress in your liver. So those are usually run in short durations, maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks, depending on the phase that you're in. Okay, now you take all these side effects into consideration from all the other compounds which could possibly manifest, as well as your maximum tolerable dose of testosterone. Yeah, so some compounds are going to be on the table and some of them are going to be off the table because you'll worsen whatever side effects you already got from testosterone. Now you'll have to look at the unique characteristics of each steroid by themselves. Of course, when you start combining anabolic steroids with unique characteristics, you get a particular synergistic effect. And it could be that you're combining only two anabolic steroids, or maybe three compounds, four compounds, five compounds, which is not unheard of during contest prep. And it doesn't mean they all have to be anabolic steroids. It could also be some of the peptide hormones, like a growth hormone and insulin. So I prefer the golden triangle, testosterone, growth hormone, and insulin. And then the tetraforce can be IGF-1, but it seems to be unobtainable, whether that's in-game or in the real world. Now, if you're a little bit confused or unsure which hormone to add on top of your maximum tolerable dose of testosterone, please head over to my website, vigorsteve.com. You should already have that bookmarked. There's an article there called The Primary and Secondary Reason to Add a Certain PED to Your Protocol. And there I go over a complete list of all the possible options you could think about, and the first reason and the second reason why you would want to add that to your cycle. But the option to add them highly depends on which side effects you were experiencing on testosterone only. Now, this list is very, very long, so I'm not going to repeat that in this video. I would highly suggest you go to that article and read it for yourself and give yourself a couple options on which are good and which are bad. Now, the golden rule here, which was the same for testosterone, is figuring out your lowest effective dose of the second compound you're going to add on top of your testosterone. So let's say you ended up at 750 milligrams testosterone per week. You want to add in trenbolone, everybody's favorite. Start low, 150 milligrams per week. That's already 900 milligrams of anabolic steroids combined. And make as much progress as you can on a low dose of trenbolone because you're already getting a synergistic effect because trenbolone is a lot more androgenic and a lot more anabolic than testosterone is on a milligram for milligram basis. Now, the unique characteristic of trenbolone, of course, is that it helps a lot more with nutrient partitioning. So whether you use that during the off season or a cutting phase, it's going to improve nutrient partitioning. Some of that is coming from the increased IGF-1 sensitivity. So logically, when you look at it, when you add trenbolone and you made a decent amount of progress, but you don't want to increase the trenbolone doses because the side effects of trenbolone, like anger management or night sweats, become intolerable, another synergistic effect would be to increase your serum IGF-1 concentrations. And you could do that with growth hormone or growth hormone secretagogue or actual IGF-1 if you can source it, right? So you'll have to look at the total picture and come up with a good conclusion on how to design your cycle, yeah, on a step-by-step process. Now, in this process, you might figure out your highest tolerable dose of trenbolone as well. Let's say that 750 milligrams test combined with trenbolone, you end up at 525 milligrams trenbolone per week, maybe 700, maybe 1000 milligrams. Again, it highly depends on you and how much you can tolerate by yourself and which side effects you, you know, place emphasis on, whether that's kidney health, anger management, acid reflux, digestion, etc. It highly depends on you. I can't make that decision for you. Personally, I don't like trenbolone. I prefer primobolan. My highest dose of testosterone and primobolan together would be 1,000 milligrams of testosterone and 1,000 milligrams of primobolan. Actually, I don't get too many side effects from that, but it gives me all the results I desire in a caloric deficit. I really hope that you understand that with cycling, there's a lot of flexibility involved. You can't design your cycle 16 weeks out in advance because the body changes and you don't know how you're going to respond to some of the compounds if you're using them for the first time. So planning a cycle out 20 weeks, 16 weeks, 8 weeks out in advance, I never do that with my clients. We start somewhere and we make adjustments and we end up somewhere. And hopefully we're ending up somewhere where the person is healthy and they reach their goals. I hope that's one of your goals as well. You reach your goals and you stay healthy in the process. And for that, a lot of flexibility is required because sometimes you respond differently to compounds. Your body changes over the years or your supplier runs out of your favorite compound. So let's say you like testosterone primo, like I do, and halfway through your cycle, they run out of primo. What are you going to do? If your cycle is laid out on paper, it's like a project, right? One of the essential parts of the project is missing. What are you going to do? Crisis management? You'll have to look at some of the other compounds or make sure you have adequate supply, but I'll leave that up to your decision. So please keep that in mind. A cycle is only as good as the results you're getting from it. And if you're no longer getting results or you only get side effects, you need to make some adjustments and make sure that that cycle works for you. And it could be that you laid it out on a piece of paper for the next 16 weeks. And after 6 weeks of following a cycle, the planned cycle and the actual cycle are completely different. Keep an open mind, stay flexible, make adjustments as they're needed, especially regarding your dosages and your food intake. Because when you eat a lot of food and you get all your micronutrients and you train balls to the wall, you really don't need so many anabolics to facilitate recovery because you already get that from the food. During a cutting phase or contest prep, you can pretty much expect that your performance-enhancing drug intake is going to go up. But during the off-season, really, you don't need so much, guys. You don't have to overcomplicate it. All these protocols that you guys send me with direct messages, completely unnecessary. Really, focus on the food. The drugs come later, okay? Thank you guys so much for watching. Don't forget to hit that like button, which is somewhere down below, as well as the subscribe button. And I'll see you guys in the next video.